offerings. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this church. We thank you that in this community of Battle Creek, Michigan, of Harbor Creek, you have placed First Naz to be a light. And Lord, I pray that you would use this offering for your glory, that you would use these funds to build your kingdom right here in Harbor Creek. Lord, we pray also that you would continue your generosity with the four you're giving. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you bow your heads with me as we come before the Lord in prayer? Most holy God, we think of our lives and where we have come from, what you have redeemed us from, what you have brought us out of, and we thank you. We can only give you praise, for you are so good, and we can't imagine life without you. And Lord, that you haven't called us to this individual faith where it's just about you and me, but you have called us. As you have drawn us to yourself, you have called us to be a part of the church. Remarkable. Who would have thought that you wanted us to be connected to one another? It's not just about my relationship with you. It's not just about my own personal piety. But it's about who we as the church are called to be. We as the body of Christ here on this earth are called to be a new people, a covenant people, a people in relationship with you, a people who live radically different lives from the way we used to live. And you've called us to join hands with one another. You've called me to join hands with someone like Cassie and to live this Christian life alongside of her. You've called Hannah and Tabitha to join hands together and learn what it means to be in ministry together. You've called our leaders of this church, our board members, to join hands and to learn to live out this gospel right here in time and space in Battle Creek, Michigan. And Lord, you seek to bless us. You seek to use us in mighty and amazing ways. And I thank you for that. Lord, it may be a small thing, but to me it's not. I thank you that we're able to renovate this foyer. I thank you that the painting went so well. I thank you for folks like Jimmy Denton who put in hours of work to make that happen. I thank you for folks like Jim Schrag, our trustee, who prepared it, made it happen, did all the prep work for it. I thank you for folks like Tom Jones who did the electrical to the TV. These may be small things, but God, it matters. And when we as the people do these small things with great love, and when we all work together, when the Jims of our church does his part, and the Jimmies of our church does his part, and the Toms of our church does his part, and the Hannahs and the Tabithas, and the Jills and the Annettes, when we all do our part, my goodness, you are going to work through us. I thank you for that you've called us to live this life together. And Lord, I thank you. You know, I didn't have to be a Nazarene. The folks in this church didn't have to be a part of First Church of the Nazarene. We had options, we had choices. But we have decided to be a part of this thing called the Church of the Nazarene. And Lord, it's still a human thing. We're not perfect. But one of the benefits of being a part of this connectional church is we can send missionaries like Gary and Penny Slidell to places like Zambia, Africa. Lord, I pray that you would bless their ministry there as they work with the missions involvement there, with teaching and education. They're working with the Jesus film. They're working with the work and witness trips that come through. Lord, would you bless them in their ministry? Would you make it fruitful? And we also pray for their three children, for Lindsay, Alyssa, and Josiah, that those kids would know that they have a home. And they may not feel at home in Zambia. They may not feel at home in America. But they have a home, and it's called the church. And no matter where they go, they have a home in the church. And lastly, Lord, we pray for the ministries of First Mass, that that we would continue working together, that we would continue being a light in this community, and we would show this world and our an alternative way of living under our new King, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We pray this in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Well, last week, I encouraged us, along with God and encouraging Jacob, do not be afraid to go down to Egypt. Remember that the Lord said to Jacob, also known as Israel, do not be afraid to go down to Egypt, for God said to them, I will surely be with you, and I will surely bring you back up from that land to the promised land. And so Jacob with his sons and his whole family, they went down to Egypt to finally meet Joseph, the long-lost son, who had been estranged for many years. And in the closing pages of the book of Genesis, we see Jacob being gathered to his fathers, Joseph closing his eyes, and that's the end of the book of Genesis. If you flip over a few more pages, you get to what is called the Book of Exodus, which means literally the way out. And we hear that generations after Jacob and Joseph, a new king of the Egyptians came to power, a new Pharaoh, and to him, Joseph meant nothing. And he looked at the Hebrew people who were living within Egypt, and he said of them, he said, we can't trust these Hebrews. We can't trust them because they don't look like us. They don't talk like us. They don't act like us. They're a different people. Remember that? And the Pharaoh, this new Pharaoh to whom Joseph meant nothing, said those Hebrews may not defend the land in case of war. They might rise up against us and fight for our enemies. What was Pharaoh doing? He was striking fear in the hearts of the Egyptians against the people of God, against the people with whom God has made his covenant, his covenantal relationship. When I'm talking covenant, when I use that word, I mean relationship. It's a covenant. It's where you say, I will be faithful to you, and you will be faithful to me. When a man and woman stand right here, and they exchange their wedding vows, they are making a covenant. I will be faithful to you, and you will be faithful to me. When the new members of the church stood before you and said, yes, I do, I'll do that, I'll do this. They were making a covenant with the church, saying, I will do this and you will do that, right? Yeah. So the people of Egypt began to fear against the Hebrews, and so they enslaved the Hebrew people for 400 years. Well, God then sends Moses back to Egypt to help bring his people out of slavery, and God brought about the 9 plagues over the land of Egypt, and the 10th plague was a plague on the firstborn in the land. The firstborn of the very top, Pharaoh himself, all the way down to the firstborn of the lowest and most humble slave. What the Israelites had to do, the Hebrew people, what they had to do was differentiate themselves from the Egyptians, so that their firstborn wouldn't suffer the death that the Egyptians would suffer. And so this is what God said. This is how you are to differentiate yourselves from the Egyptians. You are to take a lamb, and you are to sacrifice, and you're to eat the lamb in your home. You're to dip a hyssop plant in the basin of blood, and you are to take that blood, the blood of the Passover lamb, and you are to spread it on the doorposts of your homes. Maybe you are familiar with this. So the Israelites took the lamb's blood and they spread it on the doorposts of their homes as a sign that they belonged to the covenantal people of God. And so the destroying angel, as he swept through the land of Egypt, when he saw the blood of the lamb, he would pass over that home. He would pass over that community with the lamb's blood. And and he would inflict upon those homes without the lamb's blood. You see? Okay. And so, that's why they called it Passover, because the destroying angel passed over the homes and the communities with the lamb's blood. And as the Israelites continued on generation after generation, they were instructed to celebrate the Passover festival. I'd like to read for you from Exodus chapter 12, 26 through 27. And when your children ask you, "What does this ceremony mean to you?" then tell them, "It is the Passover sacrifice to the Lord, who passed over the houses of the Israelites in Egypt and spared our homes when he struck down the Egyptians." Was the lamb sacrificed or slain so that the Israelites could be forgiven of their personal sins? No, it wasn't. The blood that was shed on Passover wasn't for the forgiveness of sins. It was a sign of who was in a covenantal relationship with God. That was the purpose of the Passover lamb. Well, why would something like Passover be significant to the church? During what meal did Jesus provide the Last Supper? We have it placed right before you here. During what meal did Jesus take the bread and say, "This is my body given for you"? During what meal did Jesus take the cup and say, "This cup is the new covenant"? We're talking about being a covenantal people. "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for the forgiveness of sins." What meal was that? That, my friends, was the Passover meal. Jesus was celebrating the Passover event. Jesus was celebrating the moment of Exodus for the people of God with his disciples when he instituted the communion supper. And so, maybe, just maybe, it's a good idea to try to understand Jesus' death, his broken body, and his shed blood in light of the Passover, in light of the Exodus, the way out of Egypt. See, there isn't only one way to understand the cross. So as you hear me talking about Passover, I don't want you to think that this is the only way to understand Jesus' death. It's not the only way, but it is a very good way to understand Jesus' death. In fact, Ben, go to the first slide for me, the title slide. You'll notice I have a question up there. Why did Jesus have to die? That's a question that we're going to try to answer, and I want you to notice in parentheses, it says part 1 of 4. Because guess what? What I'm going to share with you today about understanding Jesus' death in light of Passover isn't the only way. There's more to come. So come next week and the week after. Now, I can't preach on this forever, so we're going to stop at 4. But I want you to understand that there is more than one way of understanding the death of Jesus. And the problem is, when talking about why did Jesus have to die, we only talk about one. We only talk about Jesus died so we can be forgiven of our sins. So I'm going to encourage us today to reimagine, to think anew, think afresh, why Jesus had to die, and we're going to place it all within Passover, and hopefully we'll come out today with a new perspective of why Jesus had to die. And then we'll come next week, and I'll give you a second perspective, and then a third, and then a fourth. Okay? So that's what we're doing today. We're in the book of 1 Corinthians. Next week we're going to flip over to 2 Corinthians. I'm going to be in 2 Corinthians the next 3 weeks. So if you are in an LTG and you're reading what the pastor's preaching on, continue reading first, and specifically for the next 3 weeks, 2 Corinthians in your LTGs. Wednesday night group, we're going to be talking about 2 Corinthians this Wednesday because I'm preaching on it next Sunday, just so you know, Peggy. All right? So read 2 Corinthians and come to class with a question. All right? Sounds good? Ken, you too. I told Ken I wanted him front and center today because last Sunday he was asleep. Can you believe it? Can you believe it? I said, Ken, I want you front and center this week. That's all right, man. I love you, brother.
At least I didn't snore.
At least you didn't snore. That's right. That's right. That's right. You do make less noise than my son, so that's good. He tends to make quite a bit of noise. Anyways, let's get back to it. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning in verse 23. Would you stand with me for the reading of God's word? 1 Corinthians 11:23. This is Paul writing to the Corinthian church. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. And Paul expounds to the church, For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Now, my grandpa on my dad's side died when I was rather young, and I don't have a lot of memories with him. I do have a good amount, though, some really fun ones. And one of those memories is my grandpa. He was a carpenter by trade. He would make me these toy swords made out of wood. He would make these toy swords out of wood, and I would pretend to be Peter Pan, you know. I remember actually asking him for a little dagger, because Peter Pan had a dagger, you know. And so I would run around with my toy wooden sword and a dagger, and he was good to me. He was a good grandpa to me. Kind of reminds me of what George does in making those little toy cars for the kids. If someone knows how to work with wood, they can certainly make kids very happy. So that was part of my grandpa's story that I have with him. But there's one particular experience that I'll never forget. We were in the living room, and he asked me, well, he wasn't asking me. He was just letting me in on his thoughts. And he said this. He said, Why did Jesus have to die? That's a really good question. I want you to think that on Good Friday, the disciples were asking that question. Why did Jesus have to die? But it was filled with despair. On Easter Sunday, and after that, they were asking that same question, why did Jesus have to die? But they were asking with hope, right? Because now that Jesus has risen again from the dead, that means that Jesus' death on Good Friday must have accomplished something. It must have done something for humanity. God vindicated Jesus' death when he rose him again from the dead. And so, for centuries, millennia, we as the church have been pondering what is the significance of Jesus' death on the cross. What has it accomplished in our world? So let me ask you, why did Jesus have to die? Imagine you're in your friend's house, and your friend knows that you go to church. Your friend asks you, why did Jesus even have to die in the first place? What would you say to your friend? Now, our typical response, and it's not the wrong response, it's not wrong, it's our typical though, and it's the only way we tend to respond. That's my problem with it. It's the only way we tend to respond. So we say, well, Jesus died so we can be forgiven of our sins. Okay. So how does Jesus' death forgive us of our sins? You know, someone, imagine you're talking to your friend and they ask that question, well, how does that work? And you would say, well, Jesus died to satisfy the wrath of God, right? By enduring the punishment that we deserve. And we sing that, for the wrath of God was satisfied. I mean, that's even in our language and in our songs. And then if your friend were to press you even further for more explanation, okay, so explain this about this wrath of God. We would say something like, well, God had to uphold some sense of justice. You know, we would say things like, wrongdoing must be punished. And so God punished his son in our place so that he can have mercy on us. I'm telling you, this sort of language is exactly what I would say to people. Exactly what I would say to people. I mean, the ABCs of the gospel, I would say exactly this. He died so we can be forgiven of our sins. God has to uphold some sense of justice. And so God punished his son so that he could spare us. You know what the most dangerous thing for a Christian to do is? To read the Bible. That's the most dangerous thing. Because what has happened? We are in 21st century North America, and we are inundated with these theological systems. And when we read the Bible, sometimes it shakes us out of our theological system. So here's the first problem I have with this typical way of explaining why Jesus had to die. The first problem is this. God forgave people before Jesus died on the cross. Preacher, why are you preaching so obviously? Just take a moment then. We talk about Jesus having to die so we can be forgiven, but if you read your Bibles, God forgave people before Jesus died on the cross. Take, for example, the story of the Israelites on the base of Mount Sinai. They made a golden calf. They did some really bad things. They were idolatrous. They were immoral. And God said to Moses, I'm going to wipe them out, and I'm going to start fresh with you, Moses. What does Moses do? No. Don't do that, God. You made the 10 plagues. You did all that to bring them out of Egypt. Why would you kill them out here in the wilderness? All of those Gentiles are going to say that you brought them out here just to destroy them all. So what does God do? He relents. He forgives them of their sins. Huh. Well, but I thought Jesus had to die so he could be forgiven of our sins. Looks like we got kind of an issue here. Look at 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. You know it. It's up. It's not on right now, but we have it as a banner. This is Old Testament. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray, if they'll just seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear them from heaven, read with me out loud, and I will forgive their sin and heal their land. Take Jesus' earthly ministry. In the Gospel of Mark, we have this story where Jesus is in a house in Capernaum, and four friends have a paralyzed friend lying on a mat, and they're trying to get the paralyzed man to Jesus. You know this story. You've heard it in Sunday school. It's a fun one. Right? They're trying to get this paralyzed man to Jesus. The crowd is too big. And so they go up to the roof, and they tear out a hole in the ceiling, right? And then they let this paralyzed, I mean, could you imagine being there? All of a sudden, the roof is opening up, and this paralyzed man descends before them, right? What does Jesus say to that paralyzed man? Your sins are forgiven. Now, the religious leaders were offended that Jesus would say that. But they weren't offended that Jesus is talking about forgiveness of sin before the cross. They were offended that Jesus himself was forgiving sin, right? That's what they were offended about. And they said God alone has the authority to forgive sin. And I just love, oh man, if you guys think that Jesus was soft, you need to read the Gospels, because he was no softy. I just love when he responds to the religious leaders in Mark chapter 2, verse 9. He says this, It's totally a mic drop moment. Raise your hand if you know that phrase. It's a mic drop moment. Okay. Okay, how do I communicate this in a different way? I don't know. I'm just going to read the passage. So, Mark chapter 2, verse 9. Which is easier, to say to this paralyzed man, your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up, take your mat and walk? Verse 10. But I want you to know that, read with me out loud, the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. It looks like we may need to start rethinking why Jesus had to die. Now, folks who are big proponents of it was to forgive sins and there's nothing about it, they try to use time loop kind of thoughts. Well, Jesus was able to forgive sins because he was going to go on the cross and God is eternal, so even though it happened later, it was still effective for the past. And I mean, okay, if you want to go there, go for it. I'm just reading the Bible. And I'm looking at this and I'm saying, okay, something is not quite adding up with what we're doing. Alright, so that's the first problem. The first problem is God forgave people before the cross. Here's the second problem. When we talk like the way we typically talk, we wrongfully submit God to something else. And this is the greater danger. This is the worst problem. We say that Jesus had to die on the cross so that our sins could be forgiven. And we say that it had to happen because God has to uphold some sense of justice. Right? Wrong must be punished. God had to punish someone. God had to punish. And so he decided to punish his son instead of punishing us. But my question, is God constrained to act because of something outside himself? No, he's not. God does not have to do anything. Amen. Thank you, Bianca. Is God's hand forced? My belief is that God can forgive sins when he wants to and how he wants to. God doesn't have to do anything. Look at Exodus chapter 33. Don't take my word for it. The Lord is speaking to Moses, and he says to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. Guess what, folks? If you didn't know this, I'm going to tell you right now. God does what he wants. You hear me? God does what he wants. If he wants to forgive you, he's going to forgive you. If he wants to have compassion on you, he's going to have compassion on you. Because he can. He's God. He's greater than any sense of justice penal system we have in our brains. He's better than that. He's bigger than that. Let me give you an example. Let's say, for example, that I offended you. Let's say, for example, I offended you. I offended you in some way. Just like we offend God with our sin, let's say I offend you in some way. Well, guess what? You have the power to forgive me. I'm not going to say to you, in order for you to forgive me, you've got to do X, Y, Z. No. It is your right to forgive me. It is your right to forgive. When you are offended, it is within your rights to give forgiveness. I think of the terrible event that happened with that young white boy who went into that African-American church in a Wednesday night Bible study. I couldn't believe it. The sin and depravity of humankind is sometimes remarkable. What would cause him to do that? evil. Really, it's Satan. It's satanic. It is satanic. But what blew me away, even more than the depravity of that boy, was the holiness of those church folk. How those people, the family members of those who he killed, the family members, the mothers, the daughters, the brothers and sisters, the sons, they said to that boy, "I forgive you. I forgive you." Amazing what they were able to do only by the Spirit and power of God, because we have a God who forgives us. And it was amazing to me to see this church community come together and heal in the name of Jesus. And in front of the security cameras in that high security prison, the church of God shined its light as the church said, "I forgive you." Remarkable. Remarkable. No one's going to tell those church folk, "Oh, they have to do X, Y, Z in order to forgive that boy." No. In the same way, God is not constrained by anything. He does what he wants. Okay. And then the third reason why I have a problem with our typical way of communicating the gospel, and this is more of an argument by experience, is our typical way of communicating the gospel tends to fall on deaf ears. And here's why. Because it assumes that people are walking around with a guilty conscience, just waiting for some way to ease their guilt. But that's not really the case. Folks aren't walking around with a guilty conscience. If you've had any experience working with people, you know that largely people aren't doing that. Sin is pervasive. Folks live in deep darkness, and they don't even know they're in slavery to sin. Why would they feel guilty if they're not even knowledgeable of the fact that they're imprisoned? One more example. Let's talk about church folk again. I talked about the wonderful church folk down there with that example. Let's talk about the good church folk who would go to church on Sundays before the Civil War and held slaves. Had slaves in their homes. They were board members. They were trustees. They were leaders in the church, and yet they had slaves. My question to you is this. If they were so blinded to their own sin, what makes you think that we're any different? If slaveholders in pre-Civil War period, who were good church attenders and read their Bibles, if they could do that, and yet at the same time hold people as objects, then why do we assume that other folks in our world have guilty consciences? You see? I hope I'm making sense. So let's change our approach. Let's change our approach. The challenge we face in answering the question, why did Jesus have to die, is we lack the language, the communication to be able to answer that question. Take, for example, if I asked you, why did you marry your spouse? Or why do you love your mom or dad? If I were to ask you that question, just point blank like that, you may have a moment where you look like a deer caught in the headlights. and you're going to fumble around with trying to give a good answer. Well, and then you might eventually just kind of fumble out with, "because I love them." Right? Well, okay. That's a decent answer. I sometimes feel that's the way we respond to the question, why did Jesus have to die? It was so blunt, and you just can't really handle such a question. What if we change the question? Instead of me asking you, why did you marry that wonderful man, Jimmy? I'm sure it was partly because he's a great painter, but I'm sure there's more to it too. But if I ask you that question, you might be a little awkward, like, argh. But if I ask you this, Cindy, tell me the story of your relationship with Jimmy. Now it gets fun, doesn't it? You can tell me when you first met Jimmy, where you first met Jimmy, what that experience was like. Did you like him at first or not? You know, because it's funny to hear that. Sometimes people don't like the one. You know, at first they're like, "Oh, I couldn't stand him at first." But then they, you know, they're like, "I don't know your story, but I would love to hear it. point blank, why did you marry your spouse or why do you love your parents? Tell me the story of how you found your spouse. Tell me the story of your mom or dad raising you and loving you. In the same way, Jesus has placed his death within the story of the Passover to help us grasp the significance of the cross. What if we allow the story of Passover to help interpret the story of the cross? Now, the Gospels are trying to be extremely clear that there is an undeniable connection between the celebration of Passover and the cross. Remember, like I said, he laid out communion for them on the night he was celebrating Passover, but it goes even further than that. I'm going to show you a quick diagram, and we're going to go through it quickly. Believe it or not, we're going to go through it quickly. The story of the Passover, they were told to put a hyssop in the basin of the blood and wipe it on the doorposts of their homes. And in the same way, when Jesus was on the cross, there was a sponge full of vinegar water in a basin, and we read that they used a hyssop plant to lift up the sponge to Jesus' lips. Why does John give us that very detail? To show us that the connection between Passover and the cross are undeniable. The next one. In the story of Exodus, we see that the blood is flowing down the sides of the houses, from the top of the doorpost all the way down the side. And in the same way, we read in the Gospels that when the Roman soldier speared Jesus in his side, the blood came pouring down from his side. Again, we see a connection between the Passover and the story of the cross. And then the last clear example is of the bones of the sacrificial lamb. They were instructed in Exodus not to break the bones of the lamb. Do not break any of its bones. And then in the same way, in the story of the cross, remember that it was the day before the Sabbath, and the Roman soldiers were instructed to break the legs of the people on the cross. And so the people on the left of Jesus and the right of Jesus had their legs broken so that they would die quicker. But it says in the Gospel of John that when they reached Jesus, they noticed he was already dead, and so they did not break any of his legs. Again, why would we hear that detail? Because for the early church, they saw an undeniable connection between the sacrificial lamb of Passover and the lamb which was slain to give us our redemption from sin, to set us free from the Egypt of sin. So, let's talk about why this is important. Let's try to get to the so what. I know I've been going. You know what they need to do? They need to give preachers like double time. You know, like they say, you have 30 minutes to preach. No, we're kidding. You actually have 60. You know? They say, you have 20 minutes to preach. No, we're kidding. You actually have 40. Like, that's how I feel every Sunday. Ah, okay. Let's try to get through this, Ryan. Try to get through this. Jesus' words on the night he was betrayed, he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood." The blood of the Passover lamb at the Exodus marked out who belonged to the people of God. It marked out who was within God's covenant. The firstborn of those homes and those communities of the covenantal people of God who were marked by the blood of the Lamb were spared from the destroying angel because they had a new ruler, and that was God. The blood of Jesus, the Passover Lamb of God, serves as a sign of those who are in a covenantal relationship with God. We who are washed in the blood of the Lamb are marked as the people of God, and we have a new ruler. Not the Pharaoh of sin, but God himself. And so we see that the cross wasn't just about wiping away the guilt of individual sins. While it does accomplish that, it was about marking us as God's people and freeing us from the slavery to sin. And so the story of the Passover is the story of the Hebrews' escape from slavery. And we share their story because of Jesus. Our escape from slavery is our escape from the slavery to sin. As the people of God, the Israelites were called to live differently from those around them. While others would engage in idolatry and immorality, the people of God lived differently because they were in covenant with God. And in the same way, even though the rest of our world is going to live in idolatry and immorality, we as the people of God, who have been washed by the blood of the Lamb, are in covenant with God, and so we live differently. We are called to live uncommon sense lives. Okay, so why did Jesus have to die? There is no one answer, but for today, this will have to be sufficient. Jesus died to set us free from sin and mark us with his blood as the new covenantal people of God in relationship with God. We are no longer bound to the Pharaoh of sin, but we have God. And so, the way we communicate the gospel needs to go beyond you can be forgiven of your sinful acts. We need to go beyond that and say to folks, you can become a part of the covenantal people of God. You can be freed from sin. You can be set apart for God's purposes. Join us. See, that's the call of the church, is join us as we serve God alone. Leave the darkness of your past and experience the freedom that Jesus has made for you with his blood. And so when we evangelize people, no longer are we trying to convince people of their individual sins, get them to have some guilt trip, and then try to get them saved that way. Instead, what we need to do is we need to say to individuals, come be a part of this new people of God. We live radically different than the rest of the world lives because we have been marked by the blood of the Lamb. And so Paul instructs the local church of Corinth to act like this covenantal people of God. When he says this in 1 Corinthians 5, 7 through 8, he says to the church, to the local church, get rid of the old yeast so that you may be a new unleavened batch as you really are. For Christ, our Passover lamb, aha, there it is. Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed. Therefore, let us keep the festival, not with the old bread leavened with malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. So in closing, am I saying that Jesus' death doesn't provide forgiveness for sins? No, of course not. But there's a whole lot more to it than just that. Today, we found out that we can understand the cross in light of Passover, and it has given us a fresh perspective. For the next 3 weeks, we're going to look at other viewpoints. We're going to look at how the death and resurrection of Jesus was so significant that there isn't just one answer. And so next week, we're going to look at how the death of Jesus brought about the new covenant of the Spirit. That'll be the key word. The week after that, we're going to look at how the death of Jesus brought about redemption. And in the third week, we're going to look at how the death of Jesus brought about reconciliation. Reconciliation between humanity to God and from humanity to humanity. Now, I have asked our stewards to prepare our communion supper today. I know it's last Sunday of the month, but since I'm preaching out of 1 Corinthians 11, I felt like it was an appropriate way to close our service together with the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper is a sacrament which proclaims his life, his sufferings, his sacrificial death and resurrection, and his coming again. It shows forth the Lord's death until his return. The supper is a means of grace in which Christ is present by the Spirit. Just as the Israelites were covered by the blood of the Passover lamb, which set them free from the bondage to Pharaoh, so also we are the covenant people covered in the blood of the Lamb, which sets us free from bondage to sin. And we encourage any and all who are repentant of their sins to receive these elements as a constant reminder that we are the people of God. Our Passover lamb has been sacrificed. So let us keep the festival, not with the yeast of malice and wickedness, but with a pure batch of dough filled with sincerity and truth. On the night our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. This is the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was broken for you. May it preserve you blameless unto everlasting life. Eat this in remembrance that Christ died for you." And likewise, after supper he took the cup, and he said, "This cup is the new covenant." Remember? "The new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink of it in remembrance of me. This is the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for you. May it preserve you blameless unto everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful." Would you stand for the benediction? O people of God, may the Lord bless you, may the Lord keep you, may you know that you are in a covenantal relationship with Him. He has poured out His very self on your behalf to bring those who are far off close to Him. And so, people of God, leave this place and live as the covenantal people of God to His glory. And all God's people said, Amen.